A while back, I went on a bit of a bender designing a bunch of brackets and such for 2020 aluminum extrusions, and among them were a handful of these hinges that I made for building frames that have odd angles in them. In response to seeing one of these hinges on Printables, somebody asked me about using that hinge for a folding table. I didn't think any of them seemed like a great fit, but it did get the gears squeaking into motion a bit on how I might modify that hinge concept to be a bit more table leggy. And here's what came out of that. The leg pivots on a hinge here, and this locking pin secures the leg in either the folded or unfolded position. It seemed to work well enough, but the somewhat flimsy nature of the locking pin never quite sat right with me. But I didn't actually have a need for a folding table myself, so I called it good enough and moved on. But when someone in the comments asked me to add audio to the video about that hinge, I couldn't bring myself to record audio about it without at least attempting to fix a couple of my prior oversights. Enter Folding Table Hinge version 2. The main improvements were to stiffen the locking mechanism, and a slight improvement to the bearing. Taking a look at the cross-section of the V1 model, it's a bit easier to see how the pivot works. The base has these conical pockets, which serve as the bearing races, and, seated into these cones, are the printed bearings, which have a spherical radius that makes a line contact around the cone race. So each bearing acts like a ball and socket joint, free to rotate on all its axes. Sandwiching the extrusion between the flat faces of the bearing results in a single, shared axis of rotation, which is kind of the goal for a hinge, I reckon. The intention is for the bearings to be preloaded between the base and the extrusion, carrying the majority of the applied load through the face contact between the bearing and the extrusion. The load from the table comes down through the base, into the bearing, and then into the leg. However, because the base is fairly rigid, and tolerances are a thing, the load will likely pass through the fastener as well. This could cause damage to the clearance holes, and also increase the likelihood of the hinge action loosening the fasteners. So for V2, I modified the bearing slightly by adding a second set of bearings on the outside as well. This doesn't resolve the preload issue on the interior bearings, but it allows the load being carried through the fastener to be distributed through the head at least. The other purpose behind these outer bearings is to allow the fastener to rotate relative to the base more freely, which should reduce the chance of the fasteners backing out during use. The disadvantage of this configuration is that the pivot is now overconstrained, since each side defines its own axis of rotation. So if the two sides aren't directly aligned, you can get a bit of binding in the hinge. But the compliance of the plastic on plastic contact should make this a bit forgiving, and I'm aiming for a good enough middle ground here. Moving on to take a look at the locking pin. The pin part is this rectangular bit here, which is intended to have a fairly tight running fit with the corresponding opening in the base. When the leg's stowed against the table, the leg's weight is trying to pull the hinge open, and the locking pin's rectangular profile does its thing and resists the torque from it. I sized it assuming PETG plastic and an extrusion leg 1 meter long, which it seemed to hold just fine for my standards. When the leg is extended, if the table's pushed in this direction, drink spillage is resisted by the base here and the bearing here. Ish. And to push in the other direction is resisted by the locking pin here, and again, the bearing here. Ish. And this, finally, sorry, I love me a constraint conversation, brings me to the most significant thing I wanted to address in version 1. Although the orientation of the locking pin is aimed at making this a nice, clean tension load to the base, my desire to keep the original simple and with fewer parts drove me to making the locking pin C-shaped. So this nice, clean tension load became a big, ugly, asymmetric moment. And that moment is just great at opening up that C-shape and making for a wobbly table. I made two significant changes to the locking pin to try and tighten this up. I add an extension on one side that extends down to the table surface. This one is more about reinforcing the support when the table is laid flat on a surface, but it will also provide a second load path for that side load. I also added a printed cap. This closes up the C, significantly reinforcing the locking pin. Okay, that's enough of me nerding out over constraints and load paths. Let's take a look at the build. The first step was to get all the parts printed. I think the only part with a non-obvious intended print orientation is the locking pin. It should be printed with this face down to the print surface. That's to keep the stresses in that C-shaped path mostly aligned with the print layers, otherwise it'll snap pretty easily. The locking pin should also be the only part that requires any support material. On a Prusa Mark III build plate, I can fit two full hinges worth of parts pretty comfortably. While I waited for the parts to print, I got my COTS parts lined up and ready. I'll include all the details on the parts and materials used in the article link below. Once the printed parts are ready, I started by sizing the inner bearings. On V1, I intentionally oversized the bearings slightly and sanded them to fit. As you'd expect, this gave a great fit, but it was a bit of a pain in the ass. So this time I decided instead to make a range of bearing sizes and just select by test fitting. For mine, this ended up being the 3.5mm ones. But because I just can't pass up a perfectly good opportunity to make a powdery mess, I did still decide to include some sanding. I wanted the bearing to be as smooth running as reasonable to not backdrive my fasteners. Getting the radius on my bearings free of print artifacts seemed like a good step in that direction. So I just secured each bearing to an M5 fastener with a nut, then took it for a ride on the drill with some 220 grit sandpaper. All right. ready to assemble. I started by assembling the bearings on each side, with the fasteners just far enough through to hold the inner bearings in place. If the fastener extends past the bearing, it's going to get in the way when you bring in the extrusion. Then it was time to slide the extrusion into place. You have to be a bit careful here. The bearings rotate in their socket, it can lock up on you and lead to language unsuitable for young ears. But if the bearings are sized right, and you keep an eye on them staying in place as you install the extrusion, it's not too bad. With the extrusion holding the bearings securely in their place, I took out the fasteners and visually aligned the holes with the threads in the nut. I then screwed the fasteners into the T-nut, but still loose, just enough to get a couple threads of engagement. Now that the leg was positioned, I removed each outer bearing, one at a time, leaving the opposing side snugged to keep the leg from moving out of position. With the bearing removed, I added a little bit of silicone oil into the bearing, and a dab of thread lock on the fastener. I torqued each to about 1 newton meter, by no means the calculated ideal, just a convenient and seemingly reasonable choice. After a bit for the thread lock to set, it's ready to bearing. If using the locking pin without the additional reinforcement, that's pretty much it. Attach it to the table and off you go. But for that extra little bit, it's off to the arbor press. I pressed in each pin until it bottomed out in its bore, and then it was back to the work table. Because I want a somewhat tight fit, print artifacts made the first couple cycles a bit difficult, but after a couple uses, they felt great, holding in place well, but still easily removed. And finally, the retainer can be popped onto the dowels. Once I had my four leg assemblies ready to go, it was finally time to test these fellas out on a table. I have this old tabletop from a now disassembled work table, and had all the important criteria for a test table. I had it laying around and it's table-like. Also, seemed like a good challenge for my new legs, what with its hefty epoxy coating helping it clock in at a tidy 13 kilograms, almost 30 pounds. Combine this with the 1 meter long legs on a table that was only about 1 meter wide, and what exactly did I expect? Yeah, she wobbles a bit. I also tested some side loading with a handy dandy fish scale to quantify it a bit. I applied 30 newtons, or a little under 7 pounds, before I started to worry about the safety of my toes, and while it has rhombus tendencies, it did hold up just fine to all my various poking and prodding. And taking a little closer look, I can see that while my new retainers do seem to be doing a fine job of reinforcing the locking pin, the base itself is deflecting away from the table surface. As with so many things, seems so damn obvious now. But while it is far from a rock solid table for fine dining, it does fold, so there's that. Okay, I'll be honest, I was gonna just call that good enough yet again and move on to something less table related, but looking at those clips as I loaded them in for editing, I decided I just had one more quick rev in me. Enter version 2B. I made two main changes. The first was to extend the base and add a third mount point on this side of the hinge. This should resolve that unexpected bending I saw. And the second was the addition of these dovetail joints between the locking pin and base, giving a new load pad directly to that fancy new fastener. I printed off a set of new parts and assembled them in the same way as before. I again added some silicone oil to the plastic interfaces. The dovetails were a bit tight, but they give a nice little click into place after a couple of cycles. And they definitely feel much stiffer than their predecessors. But let's see if it makes a meaningful difference once tabled. Crap. I only had 8 of those number 6x1 inch wood screws. Please hold. And we're back. Alright, table assembled. And still a little bit wobbly, but it does feel significantly less unstable. The main source of the instability now is in the side-to-side direction, which I kind of anticipated given my total lack of real attention to that axis. If my table size and leg length would allow it, I'd probably try and tackle this first by playing around with alternative mounting orientations, so that the strong and weak axes aren't all aligned like they are now. But this is good enough for me. The revisions made a noticeable impact on the stability of the table, but I must admit, I don't love the increased parts count and less than ideal stability. I wouldn't be surprised if I find myself circling back to this a third time sometime down the road, or a fourth, I guess, since I already accidentally did it. But I still don't need a table, and I think I've satisfied my curiosity on folding table fun for now. If anything in this sparks yours, I'll include links to all the print files, CAD files, and all that fun stuff in the description, and I'll also throw a link to the other 2020 extrusion stuff I showed at the beginning in case you're interested. Thanks for watching. Hope you're building something fun.